Welcome to the Workers' Reading Room. Today I'm continuing with Eight Pieces of Empire, a 20-year journey through the Soviet collapse by Lawrence Scott Sheets. This is Part 7, Revolutions, Reindeer, and Radiation. The facts of Georgia's 2003 Rose Revolution are now well documented. After years of anarchy, stagnation, and unprecedented corruption, a group of young, mostly Western-educated reformers plotted the regime's downfall, promising a bright new day for the Georgian state. Still in shock from the ethnic and civil wars of the 1990s, as well as the reality that Georgia had gone from being the most prosperous Soviet republic to one of the most poverty-stricken ex-Soviet republics in a span of only 3 years or so. Their leader was a 36-year-old by the name of Mikhail Saakashvili, whose boilerplate description usually included references to his educational pedigree, Columbia Law School, as well as his brash impulsiveness, seemingly boundless energy. Once in power, he often hosted diplomats and journalists, including me, at meetings that began at 3:30 a.m. The adjective flamboyant has been used so many times in describing Saakashvili that it has begun to lose its meaning. The revolution followed a rigged election and a couple of weeks of protest by Saakashvili's National Movement Party. But it was so swift and unexpected, its active phase took only a day or so, that many foreign correspondents had already left Georgia, their editors bored with the story and convinced that there would be no revolution. In the end, pundits concocted all manner of conspiracy theories to explain the Rose Revolution's phenomenon, that it had been personally planned and entirely financed by the billionaire George Soros. Soros funded some NGOs, whose members ended up among the vanguard of the revolution, but he could hardly be given credit for single-handedly bringing down the government. Another posited that the whole thing had been imported from Serbian insurgents, overthrow of Milosevic style. This was also a wild exaggeration. Saakashvili's party activists had indeed gone to Belgrade, openly, to study the tactics of that change of power, just as opposition movements and political parties study one another's strategies the world over. The Rose Revolution was credited for inspiring other so-called color revolutions in the ex-USSR. They, however, proved to be fleeting, their leaders either deposed in farcical ways. It took only 100 angry young men running into Kyrgyzstan's presidential palace to get rid of the increasingly authoritarian leader Askar Akayev. His successor was later overthrown in a riot, and the country descended into inter-ethnic warfare. In Ukraine, 2004 brought the Orange Revolution, which I lived through during its six-week-long unfolding. But what had seemed like a sea change in Ukraine withered away, as former allies, President Viktor Yushchenko and Prime Minister Yulia Tymoshenko, bickered themselves to death within months, eventually losing power to elements of the old authorities they had peacefully overthrown. Yushchenko, who won the high office in 2004, after an earlier vote was nullified because of massive falsification, got a miserable 6% of the vote in his re-election attempt 5 years later. The Rose Revolution yielded many actual changes. One of Saakashvili's first acts was to fire the entire 55,000-strong despised traffic police force, whose only competent quality was its ability to shake down drivers for bribes with astounding effectiveness. Many were later rehired, but as regular police, and strict measures were put into place to stop bribery, the force stopped being feared and was actually trusted by most Georgians. The electrical grid, dysfunctional for a decade, was put into order. Sweeping overhauls of the business environment meant that investments flowed in from abroad. There were also excesses, with some of Saakashvili's allies later breaking with him, often over personality clashes and ambition, and sometimes over what they saw as a concentration of too much power in his own hands. Most important, Georgia, population 4 million or so, headed onto a collision course with giant Russia, population 140 million or so, a war of words over a host of issues culminating in a real war during 2008. These are all the basic facts of the revolution, but I was more interested in the last days in power of the titan who was toppled, the man who ended the Cold War, Eduard Shevardnadze, and what had been going through his mind. A wily empire survivor, Shevardnadze had occupied political posts ranging from Soviet Georgia's anti-corruption campaign interior minister to head of the Georgian Communist Party, to Soviet foreign minister under Gorbachev, to finally president of post-Soviet Georgia, leading the country under a banner proclaiming the desirability of Western-style democracy. The throng, by now it was more like a mob, stormed into the Georgian State Chancellery, Eduard Shevardnadze's presidential palace. They raced from floor to floor of the rundown 11-story Soviet-style building. Running like uncontrolled children do, rambunctiously, excitedly, they knew what they were looking for. In the end, they found it, or at least thought they had. Shevardnadze's personal reclining chair, symbolizing his power, and at that adrenaline-spiked moment, symbols were everything. It mattered little to the revelers that the recliner was not actually Shevardnadze's. They had just snatched and torched the first one that looked regal enough to be the president's. They dragged the recliner down a staircase and delivered it to the thousands assembled outside, as if the recliner were an animate object. A living, breathing incarnation of the famous Georgian leader who had just fled his office in the face of popular disgust. Someone now doused it with gasoline, and someone else threw a match. The chair exploded in flame, and the crowd roared as if this were Salem, Massachusetts, and a witch was being burned at the stake. Which all begs the obvious question, why so much excitement in desecrating a reclining chair? The answer is the following. In Georgian, the word Shevardnadze, literally chair or seat, also means power in the political sense, and Chevy had held it for the better part of 30 years in one guise or another. Georgians loved to quip about his attachment to power, Shevardnadze, the similar ring of the words Shevardeni, the etymological root of his last name, which means falcon, and Shevardnadze adding an element of pun. The final day was November 23, 2003. Ironically enough, this was the day when the nation celebrated St. George's slaying of the dragon. The writing had been on the wall for several years. Aside from growing anarchy, reports were rife of members of Shevardnadze's inner circle or some relatives manipulating a growingly distant leader to enrich themselves. At one government meeting, he was reportedly forced to acknowledge this fact but slammed his fist on a table, emphasizing that in the world of close-knit Georgian families, one simply could not put one's close relatives in prison. As the crisis deepened between demonstrators demanding that the man who ended the Cold War quit, a nasty confrontation looked inevitable. Shevardnadze, after all, had been in positions of high power for most of the last 30 years. He wasn't going to give up power that easily, was he? Over his 30-year reign, Georgia's opinions of Chevy had swung back and forth wildly, almost schizophrenically, as Georgia's law and order-oriented interior minister from 1968 to 1972, he had been applauded by some for starting to rein in the Republic's legendary levels of corruption, but was despised and widely feared by others, who resented their toes being stepped on, or as being the source of the corruption he was allegedly reining in. As its communist leader from 1972 onward, he was generally seen as a Machiavellian schemer by average Georgians, who were always among the most anti-communist in the entire USSR, but one who managed to obtain unthinkable concessions from Moscow for his republic. In 1978, tens of thousands dared to go into the streets and protest a proposal from Moscow to make Russian the only official language in Georgia, as in all other Soviet republics. Indeed, Georgia had been the only republic to have a constitution in which both Georgian and Russian were official languages. In all others, it was Russian only. Shevardnadze waded into the massive crowd and promised to do all he could to revoke the new law. The Kremlin backed down. Large demonstrations in the USSR were unheard of, never mind the Kremlin's backing down to the leader of a Soviet republic. Then in 1985, Shevardnadze was appointed Mikhail Gorbachev's Soviet foreign minister, a Georgian to lead the mighty Soviet foreign policy machine, and what's more, a boy from a tiny village called Mamadi in the backwoods farming region of Guria. Though many Georgians said Shevardnadze never did anything that might endanger his political career, some events suggest otherwise. His wife-to-be, Nanuli, had initially resisted his marriage proposals. Her father had been executed in the 1930s as an enemy of the state. She feared that this could either endanger Edouard's life or at least put an end to his budding political future. Shevardnadze persisted with his marriage proposals, ignoring the risk, and they married in 1951. While Georgians were proud that one of theirs had become the USSR's foreign minister, communist bureaucrats in Moscow reacted with disbelief. After Stalin and Beria, another Georgian, and as foreign minister, many scoffed at Shevardnadze's heavily accented Russian and said he wouldn't be up to the task. He was soon to be a hate figure in Moscow among many Russian politicians as the man who gave away East Germany and helped bring down the Berlin Wall, and, along with Gorbachev, allegedly plotted to wreck the empire. Then came the Hundred Meters War that wrecked Georgia's capital in the winter of 1991-92, as Zviad Gamsakhurdia was driven from power. Georgia's new leaders, the dramatist Iossi Alani and the large canvas painter and general hellraiser Kidovany, however, were unable to secure international recognition, given their checkered reputations and the fact that Gamsakhurdia was ousted in a coup. Georgia could not even secure a seat at the United Nations, practically alone among former Soviet republics. Ioseliani and Kidovani begged Shevardnadze to come back from Moscow, where he was out of politics, in order to confer a degree of legitimacy on their rule. Hundreds greeted him at the airport, tossing roses at his feet or kneeling. Again, the Machiavellian manipulator as Miracle Man. With Shevardnadze's major international creds, Georgia was back on the map. Aid started to flow into the devastated country. Even when Shevardnadze officially acquit his post of head of state in 1993 in a disagreement with Parliament over whether or not to sign a peace plan with the independence-minded Abkhaz, mediated by the Russians, thousands came into the streets and got on their knees again, asking him to reconsider. He did, and Parliament agreed to sign on to the peace plan. He stayed, only to see Abkhazia fall several weeks later. The plan indeed appeared in hindsight to contain elements of a ruse. Shevardnadze was last elected in 2000, but there were more allegations of irregularities. The day after that election, I went into his office. One of his top aides, who I will call the witness, told me. I saw emptiness in his eyes. Shevardnadze, the politician, died for me on that day. It was clear he had neither the desire nor the will to keep governing. Shevardnadze made one last electoral appearance on November 2, 2003, to lead his Citizens Union ruling party in parliamentary polls. Most of his serious allies had deserted him, replaced by dubious characters known for corruption or bizarre behavior. Even with all the weight of the state behind it, Shevardnadze's Citizens Union came in only second in the elections, losing to the young Saakashvili's national movement. Even that second place result was pumped up by a lot of ballot stuffing. Meanwhile, Shevardnadze was living in Potemkin village, created by the asset-stripping sycophants around him, most of whom hailed our victory, assuring the 76-year-old president that all was well. In reality, his approval ratings had fallen to a microscopic 3%. Only one aide, the witness, had the guts to tell the president that if a critical mass of people came out into the streets to protest, he could be forced to resign. Shevardnadze smiled and said, "I might turn out to be right," almost as if he wanted things to turn out that way. A couple of nights before the day of reckoning, I went to Shevardnadze's state chancellery. The building was empty and dark, and thousands of protesters had already assembled outside, screaming epithets like Shevardnadze should be buried alive. Only the witness remained in his office. All other aides had deserted. The witness spoke in the past tense about Shevardnadze, as if it was all over. It was. The witness told me of how Shevardnadze, who had survived two serious assassination attempts and decades of intrigue and pressure, was simply not interested in ruling anymore. The way the revolution unfolded would affirm that. The last year saw Shevardnadze spending much of his time at the side of his beloved and badly ailing wife, Nanuli, who regularly stayed up all night. He would often come to work at 7 a.m., only after he was sure she was finally asleep. Essentially a lifelong teetotaler who drank sparingly and only during obligatory state functions, but never showed any sign of drunkenness, he had understandably taken to sipping a bit of cognac now and then to calm his nerves. "Of course, there have been many mistakes," said the witness. "Much could have and should have been done differently," he said, speaking of the unbridled corruption and disorder in Georgia. "But if we speak about one man, he did his best." Shevardnadze's biggest mistake was undoubtedly buying into that wildly disorganized incursion into Abkhazia, a military operation that wasn't one, at least if you define it as having a clear objective. At the time, given that the art warlords Kidovani and Ioseliani were calling the shots, he perhaps thought he had no choice until he could sideline them and end the war. A riskier but perhaps more principled decision might have been to quit immediately, leaving two of the biggest, most destructive clowns in Georgian political history to fend for themselves. The fact he did not added fuel to the flames that Chevy preferred his seat of power, Savardzeli, over all else. The decisive day was upon us. Shevardnadze vowed to go to Parliament to open a new session, but there was no quorum. Too many deputies were boycotting because of the election fraud. The Rose Revolution contingent, led by Saakashvili, vowed to block the session from taking place. A few fistfights broke out a few hundred meters away from the building. That is when it became apparent that the vaunted state machine behind Shevardnadze was a fiction. Perhaps he wanted it that way. Within minutes, the police stationed around Parliament and the presidential building let the now tens of thousands of demonstrators flow through like water. The government had not bothered to pay the police for months. Next to Parliament, army officers vowed not to intervene in what was becoming the inevitable. The government hadn't bothered to pay them for months either. The Parliament session was to begin at 4 p.m. At 3:55, Chevy called the witness. "What should I say to open Parliament?" he asked. "We don't have a quorum." Unfortunately, we are surrounded, came the answer from the witness, a physicist empiricist not prone to euphemisms. Shevardnadze answered that he understood. As the session began, Mikhail Saakashvili, leader of the Rose Revolution, barged into the hall with hundreds of supporters, overwhelming a few guards at the door with relative ease. I was squeezed into the middle of the crowd. In his hand and in front of his bulletproof vest, Saakashvili held a bouquet of roses. He began shouting at Shevardnadze, who looked surprised and ashen. The president, after a few seconds in a trance-like state, was instantly spirited away to his residence on a hillside a few miles away. Once back at his residence, Shevardnadze gave a rambling, nearly incomprehensible interview in which he expressed dismay and surprise, saying that he had raised pensions and that the country's agriculture sector was improving. Then he announced a state of emergency, but because he had no loyal troops to rely on, he later admitted to me during an interview that it was more of a temporary way to cool passions than a serious measure, especially given that his army had effectively deserted him. The next day, opposition delegates went to meet with the president. With surprising calm, Shevardnadze agreed to resign in order to avoid bloodshed, he said. Thus, a peaceful transfer of power had taken place in a former Soviet state, a rarity. Tens of thousands of Georgians descended on the main Rustaveli Avenue, almost everyone drinking wine and dancing, a national celebration. Although he expressed occasional moments of bitterness, relief at having been spared the burden of his supposedly unshakable addiction to power was dominant. On the day after he resigned, Shevardnadze calmly and in high spirits went to his office and collected the memorabilia of 30 years in power, photographs with other world leaders, gifts from foreign dignitaries, and other trinkets. He and his secretary placed them in a box. Smilingly, he went home to his presidential residence high above the city, a comfort he was allowed to keep by Georgia's new rulers out of general respect. A few dozen jeerers caught wind of his foray to retrieve his office belongings. They gathered outside the presidential building, expecting him to whisk past in his car, pretending not to notice. Instead, Shevardnadze insisted on stopping, shocking the demonstrators by getting out and engaging them in conversation. "My time is over," he told them, smiling disarmingly. "Let's see what these young people can do with Georgia now." A few days later, I went to see Shevardnadze. His eyes were clear and sharp, his voice assured. His recliner might have been destroyed in the flames, but for the first time, the old man looked relaxed and actually glad to be relieved of dealing with power. We met a few more times over the years, most recently in May 2011, Shevardnadze at the time 83 but in remarkably strong health for a man whose life had been so shaped by upheaval. We discussed a few main things. Shevardnadze had previously admitted that the war in Abkhazia during the early 1990s had clearly been a mistake, but said he had been powerless to stop it, as he was still at that early stage at the mercy of the warlords Kitavani and Eyosi Alani, and was not even formally commander-in-chief of the National Guard. Then there was the subject of the Soviet Union. Could it have been reformed or dismantled less violently? "No possibility," he said, repeating exactly the same thing he had told me 15 years earlier. The Silver Fox admitted that he had not anticipated the speed with which the empire would self-destruct. It had been he and Kremlin leader Gorbachev who, on a walk along a Black Sea beach in 1985, agreed that we cannot go on like this. What they meant was that the Soviet system was an untenable entity. I was convinced the Soviet Union would disintegrate. But to be honest, I was off by 10 or 15 years, reflected Shevardnadze, the former Soviet Politburo member. I did not at all anticipate the USSR would fall apart so quickly. Shevardnadze made another prediction he had made before, that Russia itself would break down further, along ethnic lines, especially in the hopelessly corrupt Islamist insurrection, troubled regions of Chechnya, Dagestan, and some others, all of which are almost totally dependent on billions of dollars, most of it used corruptly, to prop up local chieftains like the technically pro-Moscow chieftain Ramzan Kadyrov. Enough politics. Shevardnadze, the man so thoroughly associated with his supposed love of power above all else, had married a woman who tried her utmost to dissuade him, out of a fear that he would destroy his life because of her father's enemy of the people reputation. And when Shevardnadze's wife Nanuli died, the now president Saakashvili made an emotional call to Shevardnadze's aides, passing along a message that the government would help with her burial anywhere in Georgia. Eduard Shevardnadze, the supposed political power junkie, stated quietly that he and his wife had agreed they would be close together, whoever died first. "She said, 'We will be together,' he told me. She insisted on being buried as close as possible to her still-living husband. So I had her buried right outside my door here, for us to be close to each other. It is what she wanted. Georgia's patriarch, Ilya II, strongly advised against this. It was a violation of Orthodox practices. Our patriarch told me that those not buried in family cemetery plots and too close to their loved ones were fated to a restless, non-stop suffering after their passing, Shevardnadze said. But we buried her here, right outside my door, and I am so gratified that we did. Last Song of the Ultas. It was March 2005. I set off on a 5,000-mile trek in 9 time zones to find them. And while this is not the absolute maximum distance one can travel from Moscow and still be in Russia, it is very close. I wanted to know how they had survived, all 350 odd of them. Why were there so few of them? More important, I wanted to know whether they would survive. They were the Ulta people, their self-designation meaning reindeer herder. They had been reindeer herders for centuries, as nomads, then had been forced into state collectives during communism, and now were on their own again, living a post-communist village life, neither nomadic nor collectivized. I first read about the Ultas, called Oruks in Russian, while researching a trip to Sakhalin Island, the massive Russian island within sight of Japan. The actual intent was to get as far away from Moscow as possible, to again feel the incredible breadth of Russia, even after it had lost its former 14 colonies or Soviet republics. There was plenty to report on. The island had a complicated history. Until World War II, the southern part was controlled by Japan and the north by Russia, which established a penal colony there for hard convicts. Chekhov had taken an arduous, more than 2-month journey to Sakhalin from European Russia, in which he lamented the inhumane state the prisoners were kept in. Now, in the mid-2000s, Sakhalin was again on the map, this time in the midst of an oil drilling boom, with Western companies and ones controlled by the Kremlin squabbling over the spoils. Crude oil contracts were not what attracted me to Sakhalin. It was the natives who drew me, among them the Niviks and the Ainu, numbering just over a few thousand, living amid more than 200,000 ethnic Russian residents. And then there were the 350-odd Ultas, about whom I could find very little information. So big is Sakhalin that it takes an overnight train ride from the pseudo-Western oil boom regional capital of Yuzhno-Sakhalinsk just to get to the middle of the island, to the last depot in the town of Nogliki. Many anomalies in Sakhalin's curious history remain. The railway was not according to Russian standards. It was set up by the Japanese, who used a 3.6-foot wide-gauge track, as opposed to the 5-foot standard in Russia. The train lurched forward and sideways, snow squalls buffeting us all night on the way up the island. We finally ground to a halt at Nogliki, a tiny town and kind of capital for the remaining native peoples. I woke up, got out, and was met by Alexei Limanzo, a diminutive, quiet, but determined man, the head of the Sakhalin Native Peoples Association. We drove to the house of a friend of his, where despite the early hour, we were served rounds of vodka. When I went to empty my bladder, there was a slaughtered reindeer lying in the bloody bathtub. I had arrived at my destination. Limanzo explained the intricacies of the discipline. A reindeer's everything is edible, down to the intestines and other organs. The antlers are treasured, especially in Asia, as an aphrodisiac when ground to a fine powder. Limanzo arranged for me to meet with some of the local activists from among the Niviks, the largest of the native groups, but still just numbering a few thousand souls. Most of them were women. They seemed genuinely surprised that someone would be interested in their culture. I asked a lot of questions about the Nivik language. The women explained that in addition to the neutral female and masculine genders found in Russian, for instance, there were specific genders for round things and, more interesting, for dogs, dogs being central to the native existence of sledding and herding. The next day, a perfect sunny Sunday morning, I headed farther north to seek out my goal, the Ultas. About half of them live in the village of Val, a down-at-the-heels-looking hamlet, more Russian-style izbushkas, simple wood-framed houses. Pristine snow reached their rooftops. My taxi driver let me out of his car at 8 a.m. Except for the incessant barking of dogs, there was not a soul stirring, and amid the silence, the crackling of my feet in the snow sounded like glass being smashed. I knew no one in Val had no leads, save for the name of the head of a local reindeer collective that Limanzo had given me. Even then, I didn't have his address. I knocked on the first door that I saw. A woman in a flowery robe opened it gradually, for some reason laughing that someone would knock on the door at 8 a.m. on a Sunday morning in the middle of a subarctic, bone-chilling winter. She invited me in for tea. I declined, telling her I needed to find the reindeer herd man, Borisov. She made a motion to the left and then said turn right and then straight and to the left and at the end of the road again. I got lost and repeated this exercise at several other houses until I finally found Alexander Borisov's humble abode. I walked into the yard, which was guarded by a half-feral yapping dog. I knocked a few times. A scruffy-looking man, an acquaintance of Borisov's, opened the door and invited me in. Borisov was still asleep, as it turned out. There were the remnants of a birthday party from the previous night on a wooden table, nearly empty bottles of vodka and some half-eaten cake. Borisov had not been warned of my arrival. His friend roused him, and Borisov emerged, his hair tousled, his eyes glued half-shut, the remainder of his face inviting and warm. His first question was to ask me what the hell I was doing in Val on a Sunday morning. It seemed not too many outsiders visited. Before the advent of Soviet rule, the Ultas had for centuries lived on nomadic reindeer herding, passing the winter months grazing them, and trading their meat or deriving sustenance from it during the summer. But the freedom to move about at will ended with forced collectivization. The reindeer herding continued, but in a more regimented form. It was one of the ironies of the empire that although the Ultas were subject to collectivization and the repression of their native language, state subsidies kept the reindeer business alive, even thriving. Before the Soviet breakup, there had been 15,000 head of reindeer tended by hundreds of herders. Now, Borisov said, there were just a few hundred head looked after by a mere 15 men or so. On the day I visited, they were somewhere out in the frozen lands on snowmobiles, plying their trade, perhaps dozens, perhaps more than 100 miles away. Borisov got dressed and started telling me about the post-Soviet fate of the collective. Our interview started with the obligatory morning shot of vodka. We are a dying people, he told me, without any sense of regret or overemphasis, as if speaking of an empirical inevitability. Without reindeer herding, Ultas will cease being Ultas, he said. When I asked about what his forebears had done for a living, he almost fell off his chair in laughter. We are Ultas, he said. I eyed a few reading items on a bookshelf. There was a magazine about race car driving, which Borisov was eager to talk about, although he conceded he'd never been close to a race car and the only road in the town was a dirt one. There was also an Ulta Russian dictionary. I picked it up and started leafing through it. Borisov expressed the same sort of amusement that the Niviks had about my interest in their language. He gave me a few rough translations from Ulta into Russian. He conceded that only 1,000 of the dictionaries had been printed, the work of a quixotic Russian linguist. Despite its rarity, Borisov insisted I take it as a gift. He had no real need for it, he insisted. That was clear. It looked as if it had never been cracked open. He signed it and eagerly put it into my hands. I had more questions about Ulta traditions, folklore, and the language of the Ultas. Borisov admitted he was no folklore expert. He was a reindeer collective boss, and his mission was to resurrect the trade. Then he directed me to a house nearby, where he said I'd find a woman who was the local expert on the Ulta language and folklore. He warmly escorted me to the door and insisted I return during the summer, when he said the wildflowers were in bloom, the berries would be ripe for picking, and the nights were long and full of partying. Borisov's dog was a poodle compared to the one I encountered at the house of Alina Bibikova, which was so large and ferocious it looked like it had been feasting on reindeer carcasses 24/7. Bibikova, a slight woman with characteristic Asiatic features and a face etched with deep age lines, opened the door a crack. Without asking who I was, she invited me into her home, decorated with handmade curtains and dominated by the hiss of a natural gas heater. She explained that out of the people living in the village, only a dozen or so still spoke Ulta fluently, all of them elderly. She was the expert among them, the keeper of the language, so to speak. Bibikova was incredibly patient, as evidenced by her gentle methods of dealing with her husband Vanya. By now it was 10 a.m., and Vanya was already smashed on cheap vodka, a remedy for unemployment and resignation. He called the rot gut ayestonka, acetone or paint thinner, and just such an aroma filled the house. Vanya invited me to join him in a round of his paint thinner stash, but I was already staggering from the chief reindeer herder's toast. I told Bibikova that I prefer some green tea. We finished our tea, Vanya declined, calling green tea atrocious stuff, and Elena said she needed to go to her sister's house across the street. She volunteered, with a bit of resignation, that somebody has to take care of him, Vanya. He has this mania, he doesn't sleep at night, only in the mornings, so I turned the gas off at night. I had to visit a relative in another town a few weeks ago, and I called the house to check on him. Vanya didn't answer. She thought perhaps he'd burnt the place to the ground. When she returned, the house was intact, but the door was open. Vanya had simply wandered off to a buddy's house to find another bottle. When they get up in the morning here, they think only about one thing, where to go and drink, nothing else, said Bibikova. Again, it was the paradox of the Soviet system. Without the state subsidies that had kept the reindeer trade going, or at least made it dependent on the government, the Ultas' way of life had been ravaged. In this unforgiving, monotone climate, alcohol was the natural way of self-medication, and the parallels with disproportionately high levels of alcoholism among U.S. Native Americans, equally displaced, were obvious. Elena Bibikova was the only one in the village I met who seemed to recognize the significance of the impending loss of the language and identity of the Ultas. There were so many paradoxes at work. The development of energy-rich Sakhalin Island was as inevitable as the Ultas' inevitable abandonment of their nomad culture. Then again, the empire, with its massive subsidies, had kept the Ulta way of life alive by subsidizing their otherwise unprofitable reindeer herding industry. Now those subsidies and preferences were gone, and the only ones left who cared were fighting a losing battle. I try to organize classes to teach Ulta to our young people, but most parents here say, what's the point? They'd rather their kids learn English than Ulta. We don't even have a system for teaching our language. Our language is dying. Nobody needs it. Bibikova struggled on nonetheless. She composed simple ballads about Ulta life, reflecting on their customs of berry picking and the pre-collectivization era of the months away from the village roaming the taiga forest, keeping camp while the Ulta men herded, and, of course, her singing of ballads. When our people rode in the sleds or the men would sit around, we would sing these songs. They were called Yaya. I even made some up myself. I'd sing them to my sisters. When I was naughty, my mom told me, you don't want to do anything but sing. Bibikova sang a song she had written herself, one she taught to the Ulta children in the village, or at least to those whose attention she could hold. Ultai di risu, ultai di risu, ultai di riku, geaya. We the Ulta people have lost our language. People, do not lose your language. Speak it. Bibikova betrayed no resentment that she was among only a handful of people still speaking Ulta fluently, all of them over 60. When we die, the Ulta language will die with us, she said. Given her sense of conviction, I did not believe her. Home Sweet Chernobyl. It was a bitterly cold, crisp December day, but Nina Melnick was determined to show me her snow-covered rose backyard garden, her new shed made of cedar, her Russian-style banya, your skin will feel like a newborn's, and her prized peach trees. It could have been anywhere in the vastness of pristine, pine-covered northern Ukraine, except that we were deep in the heart of the restricted zone, the area around the Chernobyl nuclear disaster of 1986. The entire zone was evacuated after the accident, 100,000 residents hurriedly sent away to temporary shelters or to live with relatives and eventually given new, often shoddily built apartments in distant cities. So Nina was effectively an illegal, one of just 400 defiant residents who had trickled back in recent years, their determination to stay and their ties to the land so deep that the authorities grudgingly acquiesced to their presence. After all, it's tough to argue with people hell-bent on living in a declared radiation belt. Melnick is a Chernobyl icon. Irrepressive in her optimism, she preferred to talk about everything but the possible dangers of lingering radiation in the zone, from music to astrology. We sat in her home in the town of Chernobyl itself, drinking tea, just 6 miles from the now shuttered plant covered by that giant concrete sarcophagus like a hastily erected tomb, designed to prevent evil spirits, or in this case radiation, from leaking. Everything about Melnick seemed in fact designed to project normalcy. Now around 50, she lived alone on her street in the heart of the once bustling town, the rest of the wooden-style Slavic houses gradually falling down, paint peeling, windows cracking, shingles falling off, beginning to lean to one side. Hers was immaculate, the floors buffed to a high gloss, the paint fresh. She talked about the other project she was planning for the house and how the town was far from beyond repair, as if expecting an impending real estate boom in the deserted area. She prided herself on running an organization that defended the rights of those who dared live inside the zone against warnings and official prohibitions. It was not that Nina was a fatalist or had a death wish. She believed fervently that the emotional stress of the forced evacuation, even from areas not documented as dangerously contaminated, and the continuing prohibition from living in the zone, killed many more people than did the actual effects of radiation, which were also significant. And now she had been partially vindicated. A United Nations study in 2002 concluded that the emotional stress of resettlement, hypochondria, shattered communities, and unemployment killed or sickened many more people over the following years than the actual radiation, although it still remains to be seen what the long-term effects of the disaster will be. Melnick exuded fearlessness about potential radiation poisoning, but also a beaming pride shared by the few residents who had trickled back to the zone. "No one even thinks about radiation anymore," she told me, as if I'd asked a silly question. "It's gone out of our vocabulary." It was Nina Melnick, a local radio announcer, whose fate it had been to make a broadcast on that fateful April 1986 day at about 1 p.m., some 36 hours after the explosion in Chernobyl Reactor No. 4 sent chunks of highly radioactive graphite shooting out of the core, resulting in a fireball and mushroom cloud nearly 1,000 feet high into the air above the plant. An old-style RBMK, high-power channel-type Soviet reactor, Chernobyl lacked the basic disaster containment facilities that were obligatory in the West. Because of shortages, inferior materials had sometimes been used in construction. Officials put on trial for approving the use of inferior construction materials said they had been forced to, told by higher-ups that if they did not approve their use, someone else would. It was simple. Nina Melnick was handed a piece of paper to read over the airwaves from a studio in the now completely abandoned town of Pripyat, less than a kilometer away from the plant itself and the most contaminated area in the zone. "Citizens of Pripyat," she had read, "there's been an accident at our nuclear power station. Collect enough food and clothes for 3 days. Buses will be arriving at 2 p.m. to collect you." "My voice was shaking," she told me. "I told people they would be coming back in a few days. It's now been over a quarter of a century." Scientists say people will someday be able to safely return to Pripyat, formerly home to 50,000 people and just downwind of the plant, once the strontium-90 and cesium-137 and other radionuclides littering the soil break down enough to allow human habitation again, in an estimated 30,000 years or so. As is now well established, Soviet officials, once they began to understand the gravity of the calamity, organized a Herculean effort to evacuate 100,000 people. Yet they also took days to admit the seriousness of the meltdown at Chernobyl, as a radiation cloud spewed contamination over Belarus, other parts of Ukraine, and Europe. The communist authorities even ordered the annual May Day parade to go ahead in nearby Kiev a few days after the disaster. Like the fiasco in Afghanistan that showed the limits of Soviet military power, Chernobyl became the symbol of a closed system of secretiveness and the brushing aside of safety concerns in the name of meeting arbitrary state-set targets. Chernobyl forced the government to be more candid. Both Afghanistan and Chernobyl were factors in hastening the USSR's breakup. Indeed, one of the most lurid details of the accident was that even while nuclear reactor number 4 was spewing radiation all the way to Sweden, the authorities kept reactors number 1 and 2 running for another day, fearing political repercussions caused by power outages. As the reactor burned, some Pripyat residents stood on a bridge nearby, mesmerized by the glow of the bright orange flames, as if watching a fireworks display. Many of them would be dead or sick within weeks or months, victims of massive radiation poisoning that would literally peel off their skin. Those who want to visit the exclusion zone must make formal advanced arrangements with the Ukrainian authorities. The road leading north from Kiev is deceivingly serene. Snow-covered forests dominate the drive, and we barely met another car. At the entrance to the zone, men with Geiger counters bent around cars coming out, checking every rocker panel, bumper, and tailpipe. "Sometimes cars go off onto the shoulder or back roads and they can kick up radiation," said one. He was standing next to a sign with a symbol resembling those of the fallout shelters of my Cold War American youth. I was met at the checkpoint by Rima Kiselitsa, a curly-haired Chernobyl guide who worked 15-day shifts and spent the remaining 15 of each month at her home outside the zone. "It's forbidden to work here constantly because of the radiation risk," she told me with obvious pride. At the 10-kilometer circle drawn around the plant, we encountered a second, stricter checkpoint, where guards examined our papers like FBI officers checking for counterfeit currency. "This is the zone of strict control," whispered Rima. There was the odd falling down building here and there, more Slavic-style wooden izbushkas, seemingly quickly abandoned, as if the owners had fled in the middle of the night like fugitives. Our first stop was a special information center where workers who man the decommissioned plant are housed, along with the guides like Rima, who mostly handle scientists and researchers. Then we headed to meet Nina Melnick. Part of Nina's explanations about much of the zone being relatively safe soon became clearer. At the information center, Rima had introduced me to a Ukrainian scientist brandishing a pointer and gesturing toward a map of Ukraine and Belarus. He pointed out that the original exclusion zone did not conform to the actual dispersion of radiation carried by winds in the days and weeks after the explosion. There are areas of central Ukraine where the radiation levels measured in the soil are far higher than some areas in the actual exclusion zone. The situation in southern Belarus is even worse, he remarked, pointing to a map area highlighted in deep red. In other words, the idea of the original exclusion zones, including the 30-kilometer zone of alienation, had been more emotional than scientific constructs, clean, semi-concentric, and perhaps comforting politically, but having little to do with the actual spread of the radiation from Chernobyl. Years later, scientists redrew the zones to reflect that the area was affected unevenly and that closer proximity to the Chernobyl plant did not necessarily mean higher contamination. Indeed, in some cases, authorities gave evacuees new housing in towns and areas that were later documented as being more contaminated than the official radiation zone around the plant. We left for Pripyat, the eerie, empty city once home to 50,000, just down the road from the reactor. There is none like it on Earth. If a neutron bomb is ever detonated, Pripyat gives a good idea of what it would look like afterward. Almost the entire Chernobyl community of workers, from control room engineers to workers in the reactor core to cleaners to bookkeepers, lived in Pripyat, a fairly typical Soviet-style town of high-rise prefabs, a central square, and a requisite Soviet house of culture, until Nina Melnik's announcement that the entire population had an hour to pack and get out. A Ferris wheel stands in the center, finished so soon before the accident that it was never switched on. Rima and our driver allowed me to wander around alone in the silence of the city. I walked up to the new cinema near the central square, as if still waiting for showings of the latest 1986 Hollywood knockoffs. I peeked into the local post office, where someone had rifled through piles of undelivered letters. Inexplicably, a dusty but glowing light bulb hung from the ceiling, evidently never switched off or having burned out. There was not a single human being in the city, and a total silence prevailed. People are allowed to come back once a year to visit their old apartments, and it's very emotional, Nina said to me. She pointed out that scavengers had stripped out most of the appliances, even though they were likely contaminated with all manner of radiation. Thieves had even scavenged parts from cars that had been hastily buried in pits around the city after the disaster, stripping out everything from seats to engines to presumably contaminated wiring harnesses. We visited the mini-museum at the power plant dedicated to the history of the calamity. A shrine to the heroes, from technicians to hundreds of firefighters, who fought the radiation fire after it broke out on the morning of April 26, 1986. Those at the plant during the explosion or others first on the scene were the first to die of radiation sickness. Why do you do this? I asked Rima, regarding her life choice as a Chernobyl guide. Her English and her intuition were so sharp that she probably could have landed work anywhere. I wouldn't trade it for anything in the world, she said. We are a tight community, and those who are here want to be here. We departed the information center and picked up Nina Melnik at her pristine house. We set off again, this time for a village in the zone named Opachichi. We passed over rolling hills in the twilight, meeting not a single car, not a single pedestrian, not a single sign of life until we reached a house where dim light shone through the windows. There were chickens pecking around in the icy yard. 90-year-old Anastasia Chikolovitz and her 89-year-old husband Kolya met us at the door like long-lost friends. We entered a single room, where some soup was warming on an old stove, and the elderly couple began the ritual of taking care of a rare guest to the now practically abandoned village. Anastasia asked me to help her, motioning toward a shed outside in the cold. We opened an enormous old steam trunk. Inside was a huge glass jug that looked as if it could hold 10 to 20 gallons of liquid. It was Anastasia's homemade moonshine, made from fermented leftover bread. I lifted the thing out of the steam trunk, and we laid it on the frozen ground, pouring the hooch into a smaller jug that we took back inside the house. I quipped about imbibing potentially radioactive moonshine, and both she and her husband laughed at me. At our age, who cares about radiation? Anastasia piped up happily. It doesn't matter. We'd rather die here on our own land, whatever the reason. She poured the bread moonshine into small shot glasses, and the toast began. Anastasia recalled the recent history of Opachichi, where they had lived since 1946, 7 years before the death of Stalin. Before the accident, as everyone called it, there had been 20,000 people living there. Now there was 20. No post office, no stores. She talked endlessly and joyously of their decision to return from the antiseptic apartment they'd been given in another Ukrainian city after being forced to leave the forbidden zone around Chernobyl, despite the total lack of services and the abandoned aura of the place. As she ruminated about their choice to live in practically complete isolation in Opochichi, Anastasia continued to pile the table with salo, cured Ukrainian pork fat, pickles, and fish. "How do you know what's safe to eat and what's not?" I asked. Anastasia ignored the question, but Rima answered for her. Nothing was allowed to leave the exclusion zone, period. For the workers like her, everything was required to be shipped in from outside, from bottled water to canned tuna to ice cream. The fish in the rivers here have all been studied. Certain types, depending on their fat composition and physiological characteristics, don't show any evidence of radionuclide accumulation, she explained. Others do. We know precisely which ones are safe and which are not. Berries and mushroom picking, that's strictly forbidden. For me, it was surreal, watching humans adapt to the consequences of how their own technology had poisoned the land for generations. I tried to come up with a picture and ended up thinking of fish trying to discern which worms concealed a fisherman's lethal hook and which were harmless. Anastasia, wearing an old cooking apron and a tattered blouse, stirred the soup in a big pot. She was tired of talking radiation. Kolya turned the knobs on an old radio and finally found some Ukrainian pop music to add some entertainment. We downed shot after shot of the bread moonshine, making toast to the delights of the semi-legal life in the radiation zone. Anastasia showed practically no signs of inebriation. Kolya, in contrast, slowly moved over to the metal frame bed and slumped up against the wall after his sixth shot, which must have been close to 120 proof. "I've always been able to outdrink him," she said, laughing. Nina Melnik, meanwhile, had gone to visit acquaintances in one of the only other inhabited houses in the village. Now she was back, taking off her boots just outside the door, slapping them together to shake off the perfectly pristine snow and rejoin the party. Nina, the woman who had announced the 1986 disaster to her townsfolk in Pripyat, now led us in the singing of traditional Ukrainian folk songs, the content of which I could not precisely understand because of the differences between their Ukrainian and my Russian. Then, after a long last toast of the bread-based moonshine, we parted company with Anastasia and Kolya. Given their ages, I knew I'd never see them again. As we drove along eerily deserted roads, Nina sang the entire way back to her house, through the blackness along the zone's snow-covered roads. She continued to explain her decision to live in Chernobyl, and to lead the effort to protect the rights of those who wanted to do the same. Without land under his feet, a person has no essence. Here there is everything, a forest, a river. My great-grandfather lived on this land, she said proudly. A child was born in the Forbidden Zone that year, and everyone living there celebrated, without a thought about cesium, plutonium, or strontium. The Road to the Schoolhouse, 2004. It was early morning on September 1st, 2004. I'd come back after 1 a.m. the previous night from covering a suicide bombing by a pro-Islamist insurgent at a Moscow metro station. A woman had blown herself up in the entranceway of the busy Rizhsky Riga station near the city center, taking the lives of 9 others with her. A week later, 2 more Shahidki, aka Black Widows, female suicide bombers, boarded 2 separate southbound planes at Moscow's most elegant, newest, and supposedly safest airport, Domodedovo. Their large, fluffy dresses concealed powerful suicide bombs. They detonated them only minutes apart, blowing the Tupolev 134 planes into pieces as they disintegrated on the air traffic controller's screens. I got the obligatory 2:30 a.m. phone call from Washington to try to explain it all live on NPR's All Things Considered to host Robert Siegel. And although to me it was obvious what had occurred, mid-air suicide bombings, we had few details to go on at such an early stage. 3 weeks before that, another suicide bomber had attacked a Russian military hospital outside Chechnya, killing 35. Another 3 weeks prior, a Chechen woman had detonated herself at an outdoor rock concert, killing another 14. The organizers kept the rock concert going for several hours despite the carnage, either because of the fact that some of the revelers were too oblivious, thanks to inebriation, the ear-splitting sound of the music, or the enormous size of the venue, or because of a kind of classic Russian fatalism. So we knew something terribly ominous was up when the sketchy news came through on Russian state TV, early on September 1st, that gunmen with some connection to the Islamist insurgency had entered a school in southern Russia, close to Chechnya. September 1st is a special day, a festive holiday marking the first day of the academic calendar, When children dress up in their Sunday finest and parents accompany them for song, pictures, and celebration. I was scheduled to leave that evening on a vacation to the United States and had been packing a suitcase. It was the middle of the night in D.C. No one would be answering the telephone, but it was obvious that this was something extremely serious, so without consulting with D.C., I decided to stay behind and get to the town, now forever freighted with that infamous name Beslan, in Russia's North Caucasus region. After a three-hour drive from Nalchik, I arrived with Boris Rizak, our NPR office manager, who helped me lug our gear around and guard it and who would double as an additional sound man. We arrived in the town of Loslung Homes just before midnight. Beslan School Number 1 was not even visible through the swell of police and terrified townsfolk, whose relatives, friends, or children were trapped inside with the gunmen. After hastily attaching a car battery to our satellite telephone and going on the air live, we spent a couple of hours slumped over in the backseat of the car, waiting. When the morning came, it was clear that little was clear. Russian officials claimed that in addition to around 24 gunmen, there were 354 people inside the school, and because Russian government media outlets were reporting that disinformation, many world media outlets were simply repeating it. Although something was very wrong with this depiction, the government was able to sustain that lie for another day or so before the real numbers of hostages became clear. Near the back of a city administration building, angered relatives confronted defensive local government officials. I listened carefully as the relatives insisted there were more than 1,000 hostages inside, not the 354 the officials were claiming. The government gave very little away in terms of information. It was said that most of the terrorists were from Chechnya, as well as a group of Ingush. It later turned out that there were also two Ossetians and, somewhat ironically, three Russians. The government claimed that the terrorists were making no coherent demands, though that also turned out to be a blatant lie. The demand had in fact been much the same as in previous terror attacks masterminded by chief terrorist Shamil Basayev, who would later take credit for this one as well, that Russia fully withdraw from Chechnya and accept it as a neutral, independent state. This had been the case with previous major hostage takings in Russia, at Moscow's House of Culture of State Ball Bearing Plant No. 1 Theater in 2002, which I had also covered, as well as the 1995 Budyonovsk Hospital raid, which I detailed earlier in this book. After herding the over 1,000 hostages into a sweltering gymnasium, the terrorists immediately executed several male hostages, either deemed physically fit enough to put up resistance, or ones they somehow identified as members of the Russian armed forces, former or current, perceived or not. Time seemed to stand still throughout the next day, September 2nd. By this time, the truth started to emerge that more than 1,100, not 354, hostages were inside the schoolhouse. Relatives of those inside, some of whom I knew personally from years of working in the region, continued to descend on the scene, inconsolable. Russian Special Forces units, poorly disguised, moved in, going back and forth around some of the high walls leading to the school, along with young Interior Ministry troops, who were busy building sandbag barriers outside. It was confirmed that the hostage takers were denying food, but much more important, water, to their captives, and that the young children inside the sweltering gym, who were desperately thirsty in the 100-plus degree Fahrenheit temperatures, were urinating into plastic bottles and passing them about to share. On September 3rd at about 1 p.m., the end commenced. In need of more mini-discs to record with, I had just started to walk back to the house where we were renting rooms from a local family when an enormous explosion shook the ground. To this day, theories abound that either the Russians fired on the building with rockets or grenade launchers to end the siege, that the terrorists had accidentally detonated the booby trap bombs they had rigged up in the school gymnasium, that some armed local partisans started shooting in the direction of the school, and that the hostage takers, sensing the buildings had been stormed, began shooting back. A long gun battle broke out between the terrorists inside and Russian forces, who investigations later confirmed had used tanks and flamethrowers in the assault. The rooftop of the school caught fire, the flaming beams eventually caving in, incinerating dozens of children, their parents and teachers, together with some of the terrorists, still being forced to lie prone or stand in the gymnasium. By now the relatives had gone from inconsolability to hysteria, left to only wonder and hope their loved ones would survive. Ambulances inched toward the smoking school, but there were not enough of them, and the rescue was chaotic. I ran across the street to get closer. We started seeing injured, dead, or dying people being hauled away in the back seats of regular passenger cars. The firing between the Russians and the terrorists became more intense, bullets now flying inches above our heads. I lay flat to the ground with Natalie Nugaretti of Le Monde and Paul Quinn Judge, then of Time magazine, I was slightly elevated above Paul, and as the bullets whisked about, he calmly looked me in the eyes and said, "Not many people are going to get out of here alive." During a lull, we moved toward the perimeter wall in the front of the school. We were pinned down again as nonstop volleys of AK fire rang out from the building, bullets again whizzing over our heads or ricocheting wildly between the walls and adjacent buildings. Then the dead and injured started to flow out. A teenage girl, delirious but seemingly physically uninjured, ran to the safety of the crowd of relatives around the administration building near the school, oblivious to the back of her hair, mashed down with the brain matter of another hostage who had obviously not gotten out alive. Slowly the shooting slowed, then it gradually stopped. It was clear that most of the terrorists had been killed or, as some theories have it, escaped. Former hostages who had escaped the carnage ran from the still smoldering building or were carried away, many in evident shock. I approached one disoriented and wailing teenage boy, who asked to use my cell phone. He was filthy. He had been a hostage, as was his sister, but in the chaos he had lost track of her. She had still been somewhere in the gym as it erupted in flames, and he was sure she had died. Using my phone, he called her, punching the buttons on my cell phone repeatedly. He hit the redial button over and over, each time getting the same message. This number is either switched off or out of service. I felt inhuman with my large reporting microphone, not able to find the words to ask him to describe what life in the hell he'd escaped from had been like. Feeling at best an interloper and at worst a tragedy speculator, I put my equipment away. There was no prospect of comforting him with anything I could say or do, and any news value to be derived was either too callous or too voyeuristic for me to gather or to be interested in. After a few more fruitless cell phone calls, he sprinted away in tears. I went back to my transmission gear, which was lying on the ground in front of the local administration building. An editor from NPR in Washington called saying there were reports that dozens of bodies were lying outside the school, victims evidently killed on the first day of the siege, when the terrorists had executed a number of young men, most of whom they believed to be Russian servicemen. "Go and check," he said. It was not quite that easy. Near delirious Russian special forces surrounded the school, letting almost no one pass. New reports of victims and myriad gory details were coming in faster than water pouring over a dam. Moreover, the phone was ringing off the hook with requests from various NPR desks demanding news. "Get to the morgue," was the next set of instructions from the NPR foreign desk. I didn't actually need such directives. It was a natural next place to go and I was already on my way. There was not much of an actual morgue in Beslan, simply a hospital where a small basement morgue had overflowed as the first bodies were brought in. The rest were laid down in a courtyard, mostly children, who would turn out to be 186 of the at least 334 victims, many badly burned. Relatives searched frantically. On one plastic sheet, the bodies of two boys lay together, looking like twins, their father or a relative embracing each one by one and putting them down again. I asked no one any questions, just listened. Many of them screeched uncontrollably, livid with President Vladimir Putin, whom they accused of not having done enough to avert bloodshed. My office manager, Boris, a deep, emotive 6'2" man with three children, broke down and wept openly as we exited the makeshift morgue. I bit my lip and walked on. The electrical power in Beslan went out that night, and we were barely able to assemble our story for all things considered on car batteries before transferring the sound and tracks to Washington. I then downed about 7 beers and pretended to sleep, eyes wide open. The next day was a Saturday. It was not until Sunday that we were allowed into the school. Once inside, we found bone fragments everywhere, and in one room, a skull fragment, hair follicles intact, stuck to a wall belonging to a female suicide bomber who had blown herself up or set off her explosives by mistake. Relatives of those still missing, and almost certainly dead, milled about the reeking of death gymnasium, grasping photographs and asking anyone who would listen if they had seen their people. The thing that struck me more than anything is that hundreds of us, journalists, relatives of victims, and townspeople, were allowed to roam freely about the mostly burned-down school. There was no attempt to stop anyone from picking up, kicking, or moving evidence in what was, after all, a crime scene. There was no police. It certainly seemed like a calculated effort to let as much evidence as possible be destroyed. One of my most serious questions involved a gaping hole in the lower brick outer wall of the school. It had obviously been created by some sort of high-caliber weapon fired from outside the school. Later, I interviewed a teacher who had been held hostage inside. She had been hiding behind a locker-sized safe in the gymnasium where she said the Russian Special Forces fired a rocket or other high-powered weapon, opening that gaping hole in the side of the school. Many other hostages recalled the same account. This, they maintained, allowed some of the captives to escape but also set off the furious battle that would end in the schools being turned into an inferno, taking more than 300 lives with it. By the end of the day, what clearly was a gaping hole had been walked through by so many people that only a pile of bricks was left, evidence destroyed. Mass funerals were planned for Monday, September 6th. Nearby, entire farm fields had to be quickly converted into cemeteries. A crowd gathered just outside of the school, many hoisting coffins. Reporters rushed behind the coffin carriers, but I felt a kind of sickness and sense of selfish voyeurism that I had never quite experienced in so many years of reporting on senseless violence and killing. So I decided not to go to the Beslan funerals. I'd had enough in so many years of covering carnage, and Beslan was beyond the pale. I told myself not to go. I swore I would not go. I could be of no help to anyone there. I'd only get in the way, a vulture pecking away at the sacred right to grieve. My office manager, Boris, swore that he would not be one of the vultures at the mass funeral either. In the end, however, my news instincts won the day. We proceeded, somehow automatically, following the procession to the muddy former farm field, a wailing ground, women and men screaming uncontrollably as coffins were lowered into the ground. Ashamed, I did my story and left, at least somewhat relieved that a few of the mourners actually felt a need to tell their stories to me without being asked, describing the lives that had belonged to their relatives. Maybe I hadn't gone completely in vain. I'll broach a subject that I intentionally avoided during the writing of most of this book, not having wanted to distract from the stories I was relating. Covering war and scores of human tragedies, which is what I did for nearly 20 years, is a bit like exposing oneself to radiation. In carefully measured doses, it often poses few well-established health risks. As for those who continue to work limited shifts in the most contaminated areas of Chernobyl, although journalists can also suffer devastating psychological effects from even a single traumatic event, just as soldiers and emergency workers can. Unlimited exposure over very long periods, however, is unwise for the mind and soul, and I've seen the deadly effects on many a fellow reporter, from relationship problems to irritability to self-medication and various forms of depression, including a higher than normal rate of suicide among those who specialize in covering such stories. In many cases, denial precedes acknowledgement, often in the form of justification that any ill effects we suffer are minuscule compared with those of the victims we write about. All of this exacerbates the symptoms. It can also take over a decade for symptoms to suddenly appear, even if the traumatic experiences were limited in duration or involved only single events. There are also special risks in covering essentially one interconnected area, as I did, for highly extended periods. In my opinion, because of the personal relationships and emotional bonds that develop with the people and their respective countries that one writes about over such a long period of time, and the difficulty of combining these bonds with the journalistic need to stay somewhat removed from the situation. Many correspondents who end up spending more than their fair share in a single war-affected region pay an especially high price in this regard. I came to no quick conclusions on that September day in Beslan, but I did increasingly start to question the nature of my work. It was a combination of factors. My adult life mostly spent on writing about people killing each other out of the most primitive motivations. The fact that I knew many of the victims either personally or through their extended families, the sense of denial that I could report on all of it without any effect on my psyche or those close to me, and in the case of Beslan, the fact that most of the dead were children, deprived of the natural, celebratory rites of passage in this life, just as thousands of children in Chechnya had been by the war there. That is the end of part 7. I will leave you all tonight with Moscow Nights by the Red Army Choir. Thank you, everyone, for listening to the Workers' Reading Room. Good night.
Не слышны в саду даже шорохи. Все здесь замерло до утра. Thank you. Московные вечера.